welcome back to Not at the Dinner Table. I'm your host, Ryan. As always, if you have not already checked out episode 0, the introduction, please go ahead and do so, get a brief look into myself and into the podcast. This week, got a super exciting episode. I have on Dr. Brandan Roneel, who, man, has too many accolades for me to name right here in the introduction. I do a very poor job of introducing him in the beginning of our interview, but he'll tell you a little bit about himself when that gets started there. I absolutely loved our conversation. He's very insightful, very intelligent, and I'm really excited for all of you to hear what he has to say. We're going to be talking about sort of the legal battle following the U.S. election. I shouldn't say following because it's still going on right now. But we talk about the ins and outs of the legal battle from the Trump campaign, dealing with the recounts in the different battleground states, and what the next couple of days, the next couple of weeks could look like. And of course, he has that expertise that we're all looking for right now to get a little bit of peace of mind. So without further ado, let's get into it. Hope you enjoy. All right, everyone. Thanks for tuning in to this episode. I've got here with me Brandan Roneel. And Brandan, I'm just going to turn the time over to you so that you can introduce yourself. I know you have a lot of different qualities, different parts to your background. So I am not going to try to sum that up for you. Let's hear it.
Well, hello, everybody. Thank you for having me here today, Ryan. My name is Dr. Brandan Roneel. First and foremost, I'm an academic. I'm an assistant professor. I teach political science and political warfare, specifically at the University of Pennsylvania, in partnership with the Naval War College. I am a partner at my own law firm and political advisory firm. Other than that, I've worked in the Trump administration in several positions prior to that. A diplomat and intelligence officer by profession. You know, people ask me to describe what I do for a living, and I like to call myself a public servant because, you know, that's what I believe people in D.C. should be doing, is serving the country and the public's interest. But I am excited to be here today. I'm taking a breather from the post-election night crazy. So thank you for having me.
Of course. And it's been, see, today's Friday, so you've had, what, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday of just madness?
Yes, absolute madness. That's an understatement.
And before we jump into that, briefly tell everybody, how did you and I get connected? Because most people listening will know me as just an average Joe, doesn't have a wide, you know, sphere of influence. But how did you and I get connected?
So it's a very interesting, you know, and I'm very blessed to realize how, you know, we connect with each other as a fellow Gen Z young Republican. But I actually know Ryan through his girlfriend, or shall I say incredible girlfriend, Madison, who was a missionary in Argentina last year. And exactly a year ago to today, I became a Latter-day Saint, converted to Christianity, and his girlfriend was the missionary who got me baptized. So a year later, here I am in Salt Lake City, chatting with you.
It's awesome. That's awesome. And we've kind of stolen the night from Madison. You originally flew out here to visit her, but friendships develop quickly, so I love that. But going back to what you were just talking about, taking a break, coming out here to Salt Lake, what have the past couple of days looked like? I know the hot topic right now is the election.
Right.
And everybody's just biting their nails waiting for the results.
Yeah.
So with you being, would you say in this aspect you're acting as a political advisor?
Yeah, so I'm a legal counsel to the president's campaign, to President Trump's campaign.
Okay.
I took on this position in October as legal counsel just in case things like this happened, just in case we need a recount, you know. We were preparing for a legal battle, which turns out we actually have entered.
Right, and I don't think that was a surprise to anyone.
No.
I know, looking back months, people like A.G. Barr, Trump several times when mail-in voting was proposed and announced, right?
Every federal agency talked about it, from the Homeland Security Department to the IRS, talked about mail-in ballots, voter fraud, disinformation campaigns, one of my clients works as an agency within the Office of the Director of National Intelligence, and they've been issuing statements for the last 17 months about electoral security. So, yeah.
And why, being in the position you're in, why do you think nothing changed? Why do you think the, I don't want to say the excuses to be made, but really the excuse for mail-in voting was allowed.
Right.
Like, how did that actually make it through?
So, in my humble opinion as a civil servant, as a lawyer, as an American, simple ignorance on the part of our members of Congress, okay? Members of our Congress received briefings for the last 17 months on electoral security issues, which they refused to engage with fully. However, the 24 hours preceding the presidential elections, both the Democrats in Congress and both houses requested briefings from the intelligence community and at the FEC and the FBI on electoral security, 24 hours out. So simple ignorance over the last year has led to the storm that we're in right now.
And I don't think anybody was unaware that voter fraud has happened. I mean, it's been known for decades, right? Decades upon decades, we've heard about, oh, my dead grandpa voted, right. My cat got a ballot.
Exactly.
Like, it's been going on forever. So I guess my question for right now, at least one of the positive things that could come out of this whole debacle is, do you think that seeing some sort of legislation or greater security for elections will come out of this?
So, you know, President Trump, after the craziness of the 2016 presidential elections and everything that was involved there, it wasn't as bad as it is right now.
Right.
But we knew things were bad, okay? We knew that foreign powers were able to interfere in our elections. We knew that domestic powers were able to influence the narrative of our elections. He established within the Office of the Director of National Intelligence a division for electoral security, which is run by Shelby Pierce, who is an amazing woman. She was a deputy assistant director of intelligence for electoral security. This department was tasked with handling two things, misinformation and foreign interference, okay? And that was it, foreign interference. But the domestic interference in our electoral systems were never taken into account simply because voting is not a right that most people, you know, being a member of the Gen Z, we talk about the rights and privileges that we have as Americans. Voting is not a right, it's a duty. It is a constitutional duty that we as Americans have. With this duty is a sense of responsibility that comes with it. So basic common sense is we expect people to vote and participate transparently and within the law. So there was never, you know, the Founding Fathers, the framers never envisioned a world in which Americans would turn on their own constitutional duty to vote. So, you know, definitely there needs to be legislation that from, you know, both state and federal levels that ensures high level accountability when it comes to electoral security from domestic threats and domestic issues. You know, voter intimidation, voter fraud, ballot validation, personnel and voter and ballot validation is essential to any democracy. I mean, the days of President Jimmy Carter traveling the world and ensuring democracy, you know, electoral oversight in parts of Central Africa, West Africa, and the Middle East. Over the last decade, we've sent countless, you know, billions of dollars in aid and resources to other countries overseeing their electoral processes. But right now, our own electoral system's in shambles. So, you know, is this the model we're setting for the rest of the world?
Right. And certainly the rest of the world has their eyes on America. They always do.
Right.
And that's one area where they're going to see a form of hypocrisy, I think, for sure. Before we get too far away from what you were directly involved in with the recounts, I just want to pose the final question. Regardless of who takes office, do you think that a piece of legislation like that will be at least drafted, regardless of who takes office, right? Trump, or President Trump, if it is President Biden, is that still going to go through either way? I ask that because I was just briefly reminded that Tulsi Gabbard in the Democratic nominee primaries had sort of brought up this piece of legislation to ensure election security. Sure, she might have been ousted for other reasons. I think she would have been a great candidate for the Democrat Party, but they didn't think so. But do you think that the Democratic Party, if they were in power in the White House and in the House, would they still support a bill like that, or would it just come from the right?
So, in my humble opinion, should there be a Biden-Harris administration, do not expect or get your hopes up for any sort of bill or legislation or resolution talking about electoral security and voter protection. That is not going to happen. Congresswoman Gabbard and I have had conversations with us in the past trying to see how, you know, the executive branch, the intelligence community, and the legislative branch can work together more cohesively to ensure such issues that we're kind of experiencing don't happen. However, it is a two-way street. The executive branch needs a supportive and collaborative approach from the legislative, which they're not getting. So I highly doubt it. President Trump has done the most he can, which is establishing a whole division within the world's most highly resourced and, you know, I would say the best intelligence community in the world. He established a division for electoral security. No other president ever done that. And I doubt Biden-Harris administration would do more.
Well said. Yeah, I can't say that I would see that either.
Yeah.
Okay, let's jump into the hot topic that I'm sure everybody wants to know about. Hopefully by the time that they're listening, it's not too far gone. But what are you directly involved in with the recounts going on in the battleground states?
So I'm a legal counsel for the Trump campaign. And since Tuesday, so I flew in here yesterday, since before I came to Salt Lake City, I've been in Milwaukee, Detroit, and Atlanta. All right, so three battleground states, you know, Wisconsin, Michigan, and Georgia. And in each of these three cities and in these three states, I visited an average of about 15 voting precincts and noticed the same four issues in every single precinct in every city, regardless of the state. And these were invalid ballots, all right, unverifiable voters, voter database issues and glitches, all right, and sudden influx of mail-in ballots arriving out of nowhere. Tonight, you know, the Biden-Harris administration had an event in Wilmington, Delaware, my home state, with fireworks celebrating a victory because of the narrow margins in Georgia and Detroit and, you know, in all these different cities that I personally supervise. For Georgia, the difference in votes is less than 2,000 votes. That's 0.04% margin. And former gubernatorial candidate Stacey Abrams is taking credit for this. According to Leader Abrams, she registered 800,000 new voters over the last year, allegedly. All right. The Trump administration, so I personally filed a lawsuit at Chaffin County Court in Georgia immediately on Wednesday morning, which was dismissed within 5 minutes by the judge.
Really? 5 minutes?
5 minutes. So did they actually...
Hardly enough time to read the brief.
Okay. So my team and I spent a whole night working on a lawsuit which was dismissed in 5 minutes. Okay? We filed a second one the day after. It was dismissed within 15 minutes. So we're hoping to file another one this weekend. We additionally filed lawsuits in other battleground states like Michigan and Wisconsin, all which were dismissed within a few hours of filing. I personally, as a lawyer, you know, I'm very appalled. I'm very appalled by this. It is sad to see that the judiciary is playing politics. All right. As a lawyer, I'm appalled by the lack of integrity on the side of the Democratic Party and their candidates, as well as the courts. As a young American, as a Gen Z, I'm losing hope for the future of our democracy and the republic. Personally, so, you know, the four issues I mentioned, some examples of this that I personally saw myself. While I was in Milwaukee, we're going to no sleep. I'm supervising a team of 38 lawyers, right? And this is just outside. The Democrats have their own set of lawyers and
right.
Their team out there.
Right.
Funnily enough, the lawyer that the Democrats had supervising the Wisconsin votes was a professor of mine from law school, Professor Derek Mueller.
How the turntables have
turned. Yeah, I know. So, you know, I was like, oh, great. It's like a Karate Kid moment that the teacher meets the student here. You know? So I'm the legal counsel here as the other one. And how these work is, so I'm a member of the United States Supreme Court Bar. You need a Supreme Court Bar Medal Lawyer to supervise each state's counts. So every time a lawyer on my team would state that this ballot is incorrect or doesn't make sense or something doesn't add up or should be considered invalid, the other side had an excuse. It was so scripted.
So give us an example there. You talked about the four different areas for an invalid ballot. Mm-hmm. What would that look like?
So I would like to, you know, one was invalid ballots and two was unverifiable voters. I can combine these two as one perfect example.
Okay.
It was around 6:15 a.m. I was at Precinct 12 in Milwaukee, along with a team of six lawyers. The rest of them had just gone home to the hotel to get, you know, power nap, get some breakfast. And it was about maybe, I would say a good 800 to 1400 ballots had just arrived, mail-in ballots. So these were all from supposedly different voters, okay, mail-in ballots. However, the first thing I noticed was that the ink on all of these ballots were the same. As if it was the same pen used in all these ballots.
Right. And you told me this story before we did it on air. I don't think one person sat down with one pen and filled it out.
Right.
So would that insinuate that there was a group of people that bought one pack of pens?
You know, whatever it may be, that didn't add up to me. You know, I have, over the last year, worked with the Department of State and Department of Defense overseeing electoral process in other countries, most recently the failed and corrupt elections in Belarus.
Okay.
So it's not my first rodeo.
Okay.
But it's sad this is happening in my own country, my own backyard.
Yeah.
You know. The second issue that I noticed was when I was in Michigan. So when I first showed up to one of the precincts in Michigan with my team, they wouldn't let us into the precinct. And I had heard of this from a group of lawyers that arrived there the day before.
Okay.
And they tweeted this, that they were not allowed in. So I thought, okay, this can't be a thing.
So I think a lot of people have seen the videos where they're putting up the either cardboard poster board over the windows. So were you there before or after that happened?
So I had arrived after they were boarded up, they were cardboard.
Okay.
So I'm showing up, you know, I have a badge that says I'm a Supreme Court mid bar, I'm a member of the Trump campaign. I'm here to supervise this, you know. I have a letter from the Secretary of State of Michigan. There was a woman at the entrance who said, I'm not allowed in. She refused to give me any information. She said, you cannot enter. However, I see people wearing Biden Harris shirts on the inside. And I explained to her that if she does not let me in, I will call the police. Because she's obstructing justice.
Wow. Did one of the videos that I watched, they didn't have the same clearance that you did. They didn't have a document from the Secretary of State of Michigan. But there were people trying to reason, I don't know if he was just a doorman, but somebody in Detroit at the entrance who was regulating people going in and out, and they said, look, we're seeing 20, 25, 50 Democrats wearing their regalia, just like you mentioned, and they're counting these ballots. Can we at least even it out? Can we trade some of them out for some of us or have us go in there? And they were pointing to COVID as the excuse.
Yes.
We've reached COVID capacity. Is that the same excuse they were giving you?
Yes. And I've heard, so we have, you know, the Trump campaign has currently 13,000 volunteers either working from home or at the polls across the country in battleground states.
Okay.
And every single one of them has stated the exact same reason. We weren't allowed inside this precinct or ballot counting station because of quote unquote coronavirus regulations.
Isn't that convenient?
Very convenient. You know, I'm not a big fan of timing, but it was impeccable in this situation.
Yeah, COVID and its regulations seem to come in exactly when the other side needs them. But that, man, so despite you having a document, a badge, approval and clearance to be there to supervise the ballot counting, and you said it was the 15th precinct in Detroit?
Yeah.
Okay. Despite that, she still, this woman was standing at the door, not letting you in. You said obstructing.
And eventually I allowed myself into this.
Okay, walked in. and walk me through what happened next there.
So we walk in, you know, we've got...
And so it's you and a team, you said six lawyers.
Six lawyers.
So
we walked in, we saw there was about maybe half a dozen tables covered in ballots with people counting them.
Okay.
And there's always a Biden-Harris wearing, you know, individual staying right next to them or near them. So I asked my lawyers to go spread out and stand around these tables.
So they had people from the Biden-Harris administration supervising.
Yes.
They weren't doing the counting, but they were supervising?
Yes.
Or were there something
else? They were just supervising. They were standing over them and paying attention to the ballots, all right?
And briefly, for people that don't know how ballots are counted, what does that process look like? Because
so,
I think that part can also be lost.
Right. So counting ballots, again, it differs state to state. You know, it is very different in certain states. So when I went from Wisconsin to Michigan, it's pretty much the same, but then coming down to Atlanta, Georgia, a completely different process.
Okay.
It normally involves opening up the envelope, the first level, taking out the second envelope that's on the inside. And when I'm talking about counting ballots, I'm talking about the mail-in ballots, all right?
Okay.
So there's this first envelope. You open it up, there's a secondary envelope on the inside, accompanied by a declaration statement signed by the voter.
Okay.
You put that under a scanner to double-check the barcode. There's no digitized system, which again, most states do. However, you know, just to add, in Michigan and Wisconsin, the digitized systems, for some reason, weren't picking up every single barcode on the ballot, but I was being told by local county officials that it was just a glitch in the system, so you know, I'm just putting it out there on the record.
Okay.
You verify the ballot and the voter, match up the address and the signatures based on the local DMV records and voter registration records, then you proceed to insert the ballot into a machine. It's a scanner type system that validates, captures, and records the vote.
Okay.
Sometimes the machine may deem the ballot invalid, so you require a human to come in and verify the ballot. If one or more humans decide that this ballot is invalid, it is then discarded.
Okay. So if, in that instance, let's say they put it in, the machine can't read it, and you have to have a human interaction there, actually say, okay, this person voted for so-and-so, then they manually input that into the voting machine?
Yes.
And what sort of supervision is there over that process?
So you for that, you would need a member of either side. And again, this is talking about an ideal world, right? In an ideal situation.
Right.
But across the country, it's not really an ideal situation.
Kind of sounds like you've got sweatshops that have count ballots on. I can't imagine it's super well regulated.
Right. So you normally need either side to say yes, and then it goes to the local poll supervisor.
Either side, but not both sides.
Yes, either side, not both. Either side needs to verify, takes it to the local poll supervisor. Now, mind you, the manual entry of a vote or validation of a vote occurs maybe less than 5% of the time. It is very rare, because these machines are built to understand and capture any kind of a ballot.
Okay, so it's not...
It's not common, but it did occur while I was there. Okay, so it did occur. But I was very frustrated, because I got a call from a colleague who I've worked with for years, and she was out in Arizona. And a lot of precincts that were in President Trump or pro-Republican counties were given Sharpies to use on their ballots. And according to her, a lot of the machines could not read the Sharpie ink on the ballots. So my question to her is, why did they issue them with Sharpies? Shouldn't they be aware if the machines don't? And what I was told was, not all the ballots that had Sharpie ink were invalidated, but a big chunk of them were.
Right.
And you're from Arizona.
Yeah.
That's your hometown. So I don't know how that makes you feel, knowing that you were set up so that your ballot didn't even count. You standing in line, leaving your, you know, $12 an hour job, you know, going out there, standing in line in the heat for an hour and a half over your lunch break to do your basic duty to your country was somehow useless. Complete waste of time.
And I'm going to kind of play devil's advocate, because I've seen on Twitter, I don't know if you've seen the post or the tweet from Maricopa County, is, I believe, the largest county in Arizona. That's where me and Madison are from.
Right.
They had issued out a tweet apparently before the election saying that Sharpies were okay, that the machines and the ballots had been updated to read Sharpies properly, but then, and I guess the left, the Democratic Party would say, look, this is evidence that this isn't fraud,
right.
But then we're seeing a lot of anecdotal evidence of people then turning around to scan their ballots and it not going through.
Right, so for me, if it's one or two individuals having issues, then it makes sense.
Right.
But if it's hundreds, if not thousands of individuals having these same issues, there needs to be some level of investigation that needs to happen. You know, again, like you said, the tweet said and the statement said that the machines were updated. Can they validate if all the machines were updated? All voter machines have serial numbers, and all software updates are recorded. So I personally would like to see those records that all the machines were updated and in part.
I'm sure that's going to be part of the recount.
Definitely. Definitely.
Okay. So when you were, what's the process like now? What's the game plan?
So, you know, right now, every lawsuit that the campaign, so, you know, I'm just part of one of six teams. So I supervise one of six teams. All six teams in all six battleground states have filed lawsuits that were almost immediately rejected or if not dismissed. We're also trying to file injunction orders to stop the counts, to no longer count ballots that arrive beyond this point, but there are state rules in play, right? The strongest case, in my opinion, that will most likely make it to the U.S. Supreme Court and actually succeed is the Pennsylvania Supreme Court unilaterally ordering an extension of the mail-in ballot deadline by 3 days, despite Article 1, Section 4, Clause 1 of the U.S. Constitution, which clearly states that the times, places, and manner of holding elections for senators and representatives shall be prescribed in each state by the legislature thereof. So right now, you know, we have, I have a lot of people asking me this question because, you know, I'm working on the campaign and people ask me, Brandan, we already have decided who our senators and congressmen are, but why are we still deciding who the president is? Isn't it all on the same paper? Isn't it all on the same ballot?
Right.
And that is simply because of this. You know, it is the unilateral extension of the deadlines. It's so arbitrary where states are extending the deadlines for the counts. So in Pennsylvania, for example, any ballot, mail-in ballot that arrives until next Monday should be valid and counted.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
So the remedy to such a violation would be the disqualification of all ballots either received or mailed after November 3rd. So, you know, these are postmarked. But again, it's subject to how a court would rule. In either positive outcome, the ability to segregate those post-November 3rd ballots will be necessary in order to conduct a recount without them.
So would that be ballots that just weren't counted by, what is it, 3 a.m. November 4th?
Right.
That just weren't counted or just that weren't sent and received?
Weren't sent and received.
Okay,
yes.
By that date.
Yes.
So the counting might have taken an extra day, maybe 2 days at most.
Right.
But the deadline to send them should not have been extended past that.
Yes.
And is the legal question here that it was the Pennsylvania Supreme Court that made that unilateral extension and not the legislature? Is
yes.
That...
That's the argument. So, you know, you need, yes, and what needs to happen is an emergency nationwide injunction from the U.S. Supreme Court needs to be requested to halt states from integrating the pre- and post-November 3rd ballots. Because right now you've got boxes of pre- and post-November 3rd ballots all been mixed with each other, despite different earmarks, okay? Or from destroying them all outright, because that's what's also happening. You know, they're destroying ballots in certain cases. Simply because they were declared a winner. Certain states, like Michigan, for example, were declared a winner.
So they're destroying the ballots.
Destroying ballots, okay? The court needs to properly adjudicate the case, which could be weeks, if not months, to be honest. There will not be any substantive and viable remedy that the court could offer regardless of whichever way they rule. But this request should also include states that have already halted ballot counting, as the court's order could be broad enough to require a recount in those non-contested states, as well as with exclusion of certain respective states and flipping them. So let's take Nevada, for example. Based on the most recent, as of 3 minutes ago, President Biden is expected to win Nevada. percent. Okay, so he is at 49.83% in terms of the polls, and President Trump is at 48.04%. Should Nevada declare Vice President Biden the winner, they will destroy any other ballots that have been unopened. So now it's not just about ballots being received after a certain date, it's about ballots that have not been opened but have been received.
Really?
So it comes down to classification and categorization of these ballots.
So states have that have declared winners already will just destroy
or discard or not open. It's up to them.
I didn't know that. I thought these decisions of, or when they call a winner for a state, that was kind of preemptive to give the American people an idea of what's going on. You know, several states were called way early, you know, maybe 20% when it's skewing so far in one favor. But then maybe as the ballots are counted, obviously that could flip back. But you're telling me that's not the
right.
case.
And what I'm also not saying is that every state is now destroying, you know, actively destroying ballots.
Right.
What I'm saying is they do have that option.
Okay.
And what the Trump campaign is trying to achieve here is completely remove that option.
Okay.
That all, it's either...
Yeah. Because we're saying we need to do a recount, and we can't recount if there's nothing to count.
And I am a strong believer, both professionally and personally, of no middle ground. You either do something wholeheartedly and fully, or you don't do it at all.
Okay.
So if you want to recount, we're going to recount everything, which includes all ballots.
Okay.
So now there's two legal arguments made here. One, should we separate ballots received and earmarked, sent before November 3rd or after November 3rd? Versus recounting all ballots versus the destruction of ballots. So it's very arbitrary,
okay.
And it is subject to interpretation of the courts.
And from what I've understood, if that legal battle that would be taken to the Supreme Court is over the Supreme Court in Pennsylvania extending the deadline,
mm-hmm.
What about states that didn't make that extension? What's the legal ground there?
So, I mean, again, these are more liberally leaning states.
Right.
And their judiciaries are a reflection of these states, to be
right.
honest. Which is why a Supreme Court nationwide injunction would be required.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, that would just stop the counting altogether.
Yes.
One thing I did want to introduce before we kind of progress after that is... if we do separate the ballots between what's earmarked before November 3rd, what's earmarked after, did you have a chance to see the video produced by Project Veritas with a whistleblower from the United States Postal Service, where he talks about how he received instruction from the postmaster to stamp ballots that were, to stamp them with the day before. So it was November 4th, and they were instructed just to stamp them with November 3rd so they could be counted. Is there going to be any... I mean, it seems like there's a clear injustice there, but is there real legal grounds to be fought there?
So, you know, the Whistleblower Act, just like in any other federal agency, is pretty straightforward. There is a process of how to go about reporting these issues. That I have watched the video. If that employee, you know, again, was seriously and truthfully alleging that activity, then he should have gone through the proper channels. Posting it on social media isn't how whistleblower gets attention, right? That's not how the protocol works. However, the House committees, the House Administration Committees, and the Congressional Oversight Committee did in fact request, they did send us a letter, I believe it was on Wednesday morning, to Postmaster General, requesting that they meet him at his earliest convenience regarding such a matter.
Okay.
However, because it is an ongoing investigation, there's nothing more to be said to that. Whether or not these allegations were true is to be seen.
Okay. So, kind of shaky just because the whistleblower didn't go about whistleblowing
right.
the right way. Went more for the publicity stunt going through Project Veritas. Okay, that makes sense. So with this legal battle, you kind of already talked about it going to the United States Supreme Court based on Pennsylvania's actions there with the extension of the ballots and when they could be accepted. You mentioned that process could take several weeks, months, right, to adjudicate. So is it likely that that would take us past the inauguration date for the new president, whether that is Joe Biden or President Trump?
So in a normal situation, in a normal electoral process, right, you know, when it was a presidential election, the Electoral College meets, I would say, around December 14th or 15th of every 4 years to actually put their official votes in. So what we're seeing on the news and the media is a projection of what the Electoral College will vote for from each state.
Okay.
But they don't vote until December 14th or around that time. So in an ideal world, and I keep saying ideal world because, you know, we all know
it's not ideal.
Right. But that the legal battle should be handled by then.
Okay.
Okay. A lot of people love comparing this to Bush v. Gore.
Right.
I absolutely hate doing that. Every lawyer that I've met has told non-lawyers to not do that. Because they're two very different situations.
Okay. Just briefly elaborate on that for those that aren't as familiar in depth with Bush v. Gore.
So in the Bush v. Gore situation, it was very different because it was one county, right? It was one county that mattered, really. And it was a decision of the United States Supreme Court on December 12th, 2000. That settled the recount dispute in Florida's 2000 presidential election between George W. Bush and Al Gore. And what had happened was there was a recount of all undervotes, over 61,000 ballots. Now you have to understand that certain states have an automatic trigger in place. Should the vote margin be narrow or underneath a certain amount, automatic recount. So certain states like Nevada, for example, have that. California, New York, and now Florida. Okay. So that case was regarding a certification made by the Florida Secretary of State, Katherine Harris, to stand for George W. Bush, who thereby won Florida's 25 electoral votes. So Florida's votes gave Bush, the Republican candidate at the time, the electoral votes he needed. And the President Trump v. potentially Biden-Harris case, that would be very, very different because
it's not one county.
It's not one county, nor is it an automatic trigger of recount, but rather a systemic fraud. It is fraud occurring across all levels in terms of voter and ballots in different counties and different states across the nation. So it is a very different case.
Gotcha. Okay. So not to compare the two. That's a good takeaway for myself and everybody else listening.
Of course.
I know that's kind of an easy comparison to make, but I'm glad you advised us of that. So looking, you said an ideal world, we want to see that done before the Electoral College officially makes their vote and we head into inauguration season. My next topic to jump into is then, what do we think is going to happen in each of these three scenarios where it's recounted and Donald Trump comes out to be the winner, or President Trump comes out to be the winner, be reelected, or turns out Joe Biden did win fairly despite the fraud, or despite what happens there in the legal battle, Joe Biden becomes elected president, or in the case that neither concede, and we go into this state of, we don't really know. So let's talk about what would happen in each of those cases.
So, you know, President Trump during the last debate stated this, he was asked a very similar question. He said, well, if he's reelected, he'd like to go back to governing.
Right.
Right, you know, Americans are losing their jobs, their homes, their livelihoods, and their lives. And we need stable leadership in Washington. We need leaders to govern, to lead our country. The entire world is watching, and we are more vulnerable than we've ever been since 9/11. Right now, we're so focused on the electoral system, where we're foregoing matters of national security, homeland security, foreign defense posture, diplomacy. The entire world is going through a pandemic.
Right.
But that's not the focus right now. The focus is trying to determine who's in charge.
Right.
So the ship's sinking, and we're trying to figure out who the captain is.
Right.
That's not what America is, and that's never what America was. In the event President Trump gets reelected, he will return to governing. Focus on continuing and finalizing the Afghanistan exit strategy and the Middle Eastern peace treaties with Israel and Arab states. If President Biden wins, he's already made it very clear. He's launched a transition website. I can't remember what the name of the website was offhand because it was very long. It was like four different words, just one word too many for a website.
Right.
And he talked about, he had a paragraph, just a simple paragraph on his website, saying that his plan was to come up with solutions to get America back on track. Okay, so we have a president with a track record of the last 4 years of booming the economy, more jobs than ever had. The entire world respects us a little bit more. We are stronger on the global geopolitical sphere with strategic advantage across all regions. We have supported defense readiness across the world. We have partnerships and coalitions stronger than ever before. Versus somebody who's been in office, a politician, a career politician, the last 47 years, and now decides to actually do something different. Okay. As Gen Z, I don't buy it.
Right. Yeah, I wouldn't either.
Right. Because our generation should not be inheriting the mess that the establishment and people in the swamp like Joe R. Biden have created over the last 47 years. I don't need another issue for our generation to handle.
Right. And you've worked, we've talked about extensively in the past, you've worked with those issues that have just fallen into your lap from generations ago.
Right.
You're absolutely right there. We don't need that.
Right.
What do you think about if neither candidate concedes? If the legal process goes past that date and we don't have a winner determined by the traditional date, what do you think will happen?
Well, first off, I would pray that
right.
doesn't happen.
Yeah.
Because if so, God help us all.
Yeah.
As of tonight, both candidates have declared victory.
Okay.
So both candidates have considered themselves the winner. I'm going to try and sound slightly nonpartisan here, for a better lack of words, and say both candidates have prematurely stated victory.
Right.
Okay. Should this legal battle drag on in the courts for beyond the December 14th deadline, then expect the economy to tank. Okay. The economy that President Trump has revived in the last 4 years will drop drastically.
Why is that?
Because of instability. There's no clear leadership. There's no one to run the country, okay? The next thing is, we're going to be so vulnerable to foreign threats, okay? The United States Cyber Command, in partnership with the National Threat Assessment Center that's run by the United States Secret Service, released a report about 2 weeks ago which stated that America has received the most cyber threats and cyber attacks in the last 6 months alone than they ever have in history. And this will only get worse should we not have a clear leader in sight. So now, banks, okay, being affected. The Department of the Treasury was hacked about 3.5 weeks ago. The Treasury Department.
So you would see it'd be an opportune moment for any foreign threat.
Yes.
To launch an attack.
Absolutely.
So more so than this civil war people have talked about
right.
between the right and the left, you think they would come from an outside?
Of course. And here's what I think. You know, this whole civil war concept between the right and the left. And here's what we don't. America is already such a divided nation.
Right.
It is such a divided nation. And the civil war fearmongering by politicians, right? I currently live in Washington, D.C. Mayor Muriel Bowser, the week of the election and days preceding it, made some several very strong statements saying, you know, stock up on groceries, stay safe, lock your doors. It's going to be very dangerous. The city, she sent an email to all D.C. Metro Police officers telling them, whether you're off on duty to at work in uniform, full gear, on election night. The city was afraid. Washington, D.C., as Reagan called it, the city on the hill, the pinnacle of democracy to the world, was boarded up the night of our elections. People afraid to leave their houses. Supermarkets were literally made empty the night before. People went and bought everything they needed to. Fear-mongering is not helping. But this fear-mongering is only being further empowered and instigated by foreign actors. About 2.5 weeks ago, the FBI, the Department of Justice, issued an indictment and a grand jury hearing against Russian military unit 74455. I don't know if you've heard of them.
Not particularly. No.
Okay. So it is a group of Russian military hackers who hacked into, you know, the South Korean Olympic Games, for example. They hacked into the South Korean government, the United States government. They hacked into a group of hospitals in Pennsylvania State. They're using ransomware and other tactics to incite fear and violence. They're using social media to fuel the flames of a civil war. As Americans, I think to myself and I ask my fellow Americans, who are we fighting against if not against ourselves here?
Right.
Who is a real enemy? You know, and the lack of proper leadership, the lack of indecisiveness, and the lack of integrity will lead to us being more vulnerable than ever from foreign interference in our democracy, more than it already has.
I'm glad you're saying that, because I think that's an angle that is so easily forgotten by everybody looking at the situation, because you're absolutely right. The election has pulled so much focus away from so many other areas of our defense that our eyes are normally set on, right? All of these different departments that you mentioned, the Department of Homeland Security, Secretary of State, CIA, the FBI, you talked about different places and military strategies that we have set in place. All of that is being put on hold.
Yes.
Now, all of it, all of it, all eyes in every aspect of the government is being put on the election. And as we talked about before, I mean, with this amount of fraud that we're talking about, to some degree it deserves it, but we can't afford to sacrifice on the other front.
And misinformation and disinformation isn't helping either.
Right.
You know, and the Democrats have, you know, have been constantly tweeting out several pieces of false information that only provokes people even further.
So, again, if I understand you correctly, it'll create more of a threat for from an external enemy than it will from internal.
Yes.
It's not going to be us against each other. It's going to be somebody else coming.
Pretty much.
And would that be, from your experience and knowledge, would we just see cyber attacks, or do you think there is cause for...
Well, I mean, you know...
Is that kind of the first step?
Right. So, you know, two things. I read a report this morning, and again, these aren't making the news cycles right now, but there was a terrorist attack in Pakistan. There was a terrorist attack in Iraq. There was a terrorist attack in Afghanistan. We have troops out there, right? We currently have 7,500 troops in Afghanistan. There was an attack at a location very close to one of our very main military bases. I served my country in Iraq for 2 years, so I know what it's like. And right now, we're not concerned about the safety and well-being of our service members. We're concerned about which party gets to pick the president, which party gets to take control of the Senate. So we are deprioritizing defense. We're deprioritizing homeland security. We're deprioritizing veterans affairs. We're deprioritizing the homelessness crisis that just plagued our country. Speaker Pelosi's district, herself, her district, which she rarely visits, has the highest homeless population in the country, of which 1 out of 3 homeless people in America are veterans. Okay? 22 veterans commit suicide every single day in America. So right now, while you and I are having this conversation, 22 men and women have killed themselves today. We aren't talking about these issues because we're trying to decide who's going to run the country. We are too busy polarizing politics. We are picking politics over people. And I don't think that's fair in anybody.
That reminds me of a quote that my ethics and values professor always brings up. It's from a philosopher whose name I should remember right now, but that we always need to treat people as ends and not means. Right? Always treat people, the infinite worth of a life means that they're always going to be treated as an end and not as a mean. And just like you're saying right now, we're so concerned about polarizing something that should be streamlined, something that should be nonpartisan. The act of voting itself and that process should be nonpartisan, even though it deals with, right, different parties competing for each other or competing with each other for power. Sure, that's what it's all about. But how we go about it, the integrity of it, shouldn't be something that's polarized.
Right.
And it is right now. And that's what's something that should have been finished by November 3rd, maybe November 4th in those states we needed to count after. But to see it go on into the weekend until next week, maybe we don't realize it as much, but I'm sure with your background, you'd be able to tell us, if you take your eyes off of defense and national security for more than, what, 20 minutes? And we're talking
20
about
seconds, really.
We're talking about a week here that right. we're focusing everything on this election when it shouldn't be. I can see what you're saying, is what I'm trying to say.
Right. And you know, it reminds me of something from the scriptures, from 2 Nephi chapter 2, which states, For it must needs be that there is an opposition in all things, right? So right now what we're seeing is what democracy looks like. Is the push and pull, the opposition, the debate, the argument. So that's perfectly fine. But the moment it is needlessly and unnecessarily dragged on at the taxpayer expense, affecting the lives of every single American, the security of every single ally, that's when it becomes an issue, right? Not just from that, from a domestic standpoint. People are scared. People are afraid. People want to know what's going to happen a month from now. Are they going to have food on the table? Are they going to have jobs? Can they send their kids to school? I had a dear friend of mine text me the day before the election saying, can I send my kids to school today? Or should I keep them home? And that's what every American is feeling, regardless of their political affiliation.
Right. So you created that environment.
Yes.
Right? Created a hostile environment. And I think one thing I just want to point out before we wrap things up here is this isn't just about the time period between November 3rd and right now. When you say there's Americans that are waiting for food to be put on the table, that are waiting for jobs to come back, that are waiting for opportunity just to work, right? They don't even want a handout. They just want the ability to work. It's been taken away from them because of lockdowns and restrictions, right? What I hope I can verbalize this for you, but what we're talking about is those lockdowns and the stimulus bill, all of that has been put on hold. Like, dealing with all of that has been put on hold until after the election.
Yes.
So things that could have been resolved this summer in June.
Well, you know, minority leader Chuck Schumer of the Senate said, he said the following words the day the president announced Justice Amy Coney Barrett's nomination to the Supreme Court. He said, and I quote, "I will personally not allow any bill that was either pre-agreed upon to be passed to leave the Senate floor." And I met, on my flight to Salt Lake City, actually, I was talking to the cabin crew and to the pilots on the aircraft who were all having to work reduced hours, next to nothing, right? One flight or two flights a month now, because they could not get the CARES Act, the HEROES Act, all the different bills needed to be passed, simply because the Democrats are holding that. During the last debate, the moderator asked Vice President Biden, she said, what are you doing about this? You are the leader of the Democratic Party. What have you said to them? And he kept saying, well, I was going to have a discussion with them. And she asked again, she said, did you have a conversation with Chuck Schumer, with Nancy? Did you have a conversation to talk about the issues? And Vice President Biden refused to answer that question. Okay. President Trump's cabinet officials, his Secretary Mnuchin of the Treasury, is on Capitol Hill every single day trying to get something passed. So that isn't a clear indicator of the difference between a president who actually wants something done for his country versus a presidential candidate who attempts, supposedly, to try and change his country. I don't know what is.
It's a great point. And so I think if anything for us to be hopeful for, something for us to pull away from this as we go into the next month, could be 2-3 months of uncertainty, what would that message be? Just to wrap it up in a couple, maybe 2 minutes.
You know, I think the message would be that we need to educate ourselves, right? We can't let the liberal media and the false narratives be shoved down our throats by the media. Let us decide how to live our lives. We are Americans. We are humans. We are families. We are communities. We are friends. We are brothers. We are sisters. We have the ability to think for ourselves and decide for ourselves what is right. We need to turn on our computers and actually read. Take out our phones and read. Not listen and watch what we're expected to be told and how we should behave and what we should do and act and think. Rather, think for ourselves. Share correct information with your family. The right information. Not what you're told is right, but what you believe to be true. The truth and the facts are the only way that we can escape this paradigm shift that the fake news media has put us in. That's the only way that we will achieve peace and stability. Sadly, perception has become reality. And that's why we are having issues now. This is why we can't agree on who the president is, because of a 0.1% margin.
It reminds me, just a closing thought here, reminds me of a quote that my AP US history teacher would say repeatedly when discussing the Revolutionary War. He said, the Revolutionary War was fought over oppression perceived, not over oppression endured. And I think that perfectly captures the point you're talking about right now, where so much of this politicization is being caused by oppression, racism, bigotry perceived and not endured.
Agreed.
And driving us apart, e.g. all of the different examples we just went through.
Yep.
So
exactly.
Well, hey, thanks for coming on, Brandon.
I appreciate
your time today.
Thank you for having
me. We're finishing up at 1:55 a.m. Perfect time to have these conversations.
Excellent.
But hope we'll have you on again.
Thank you so much.